Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for coming. I'm very glad that you guys are all here today. My name is Johan Jackson. I'm a voiceover actor in Sentai Film Wars and actor of local theaters here in Houston, which is the Gastronomy Theater. I got involved with these guys through a mutual friend. I heard about some fantastic work and was very pleased to be invited to be the host and moderator of their very first happening panel. I am sure that they will not be last. This is a fantastic opportunity for me and for you guys to get to meet and speak to a rising manga studio on the ascent. Doesn't always happen. So, without further ado, please join me in welcoming to the stage the artist and creators of Blaze-Manga, Simon and Negro Blaze. Brittany G. and Colin Intervante. Now, we've got a lot of great stuff to talk about today about the making of a voiceover manga. It's a really interesting content. Before we do that, maybe you guys could share a little bit about your background, history behind you guys.
Thank you for coming, guys. First of all, I'm Simon Blaze. This is my brother, Pedro.
So first of all, hi, my name is Pedro Blaze, and what an amazing turnout. I'm very excited to see all of you here. My hope is that everybody walks out a little bit more inspired to follow your passion or your goals, whether in the anime industry like we have, it's been an amazing journey, or in anything else that life may have to offer. But very excited to be here and talk about our project and our inspirations, everything that has led to this point, because it's been a long journey. It's been a lot of years, and if any of you are into anime or manga making, we want to make sure that you're encouraged to keep following that passion.
How many people here are artists? How many of you guys are artists?
Awesome.
Hi, I'm Brittany. I was acting from a very young age. I did theater from middle school, high school, and then I went to college and I got a theater degree, despite my dad saying, "Are you sure you don't want a backup?" And so I did some film acting and commercials in the Houston, Austin area. And then VO work kind of just fell in my lap. Amazing community here in Houston. And it's kind of like you have to know somebody who knows somebody who knows. And I actually got involved with these guys through Loraldo and Zoldua, and the rest is history.
Hi, folks. My name is Colin. I'm a local filmmaker. I'm trying to remember how I got into this. I'm not sure if I was drugged or anything. How did you guys get me over here? Do you remember?
The way we get to know Colin was through another friend, Christian, who has a film studio, and he wanted us to work with him doing a comic book adaptation of his short films, and he used to have meetings with all the filmmakers in town, and through one of those meetings is how we met Colin. One of those meetings.
All right, yeah, I'll buy that.
Okay, so now remember the story. It goes like this. So I'm a filmmaker, and we have a friend named Christian Briones. And Christian is another great filmmaker, local here. And we met at his film studio.
Yes.
Got you. Okay. We met at his film studio. Simon and Pedro were working on a manga it was a prequel to a LARPing a short film. And I met up with these guys. Yeah, LARPing. It's somewhere. It's somewhere out there. That was back in 2013, okay, so slow down. We've improved a lot since then. And so we met there, and I might have stupidly said that I wanted to do voice acting, because I think I grew up when Toonami was the thing. Like, I would come home from school, I was watching Sailor Moon, Ronin Warriors, I was watching Dragon Ball Z, Cowboy Bebop, Big O, and what else am I missing? Inuyasha, what else am I missing here? Naruto, I was watching all of it. And I would go down to the local gas station and pick up newest issue of like Shonen Jump. So I've been like into this since I could get on my mother's nerves. And so I might have told them that, hey, I would love to voice act, and why they took a chance on me, I will never know. Because this is my first voice acting role. And thank you. And I'm really, really appreciative of these two gentlemen for taking a chance on me.
I will say we started working on this version of the story in 2013, I will say.
You guys got your start as artists and creators even before that, at a young age.
Yeah.
Before you came here, I had the pleasure of having lunch with these guys, and it was really interesting to learn not only have they created something unique here, but they did it in a whole other language, moved from another country, in English, which is their second language, and was able to put together something like that. Can you talk a little bit about what was that?
The transition was very interesting because when we were in school in Costa Rica, we got, for example, me, I get bored in biology class, so I started doodling and doing stick figures of little comic strips. And then Pedro is my younger brother, so he will look at them and like, I can do that better.
It wasn't really like I can do it better. It was more like I was looking up to you, being the younger brother. I'm like, that's so cool. I want to do that too, but. Somehow, maybe, I don't know if it was a gift in me, or more practice because I was doing it more often. I became a little bit better, just slowly but surely. I kept getting better and better. But just stick figures, simple drawings just like that in the screen. He would make his own stories, but his stories were complex. They had an idea. They had development. My stories were just silly, stupid things. People fighting for stupid stuff, and that's how basically our story came to be. Because he came up with something, and I added to it, and then we built together on that. So our story, Iridescent, was born out of stick figures, just a stick figure idea, and I think that's amazing. I think a lot of people don't realize that they have a lot of creativity in their mind, but they think they don't have the talent to get it going. And you can start with stick figures and then just keep building on that, keep developing your art style, and it will get better. It definitely was a challenge, like Jovan was saying, transitioning from a Spanish country to United States. We had all the idea already written in Spanish, but we learned English and then we translated the story. His job has been, I think, the hardest because he's had to write the story in English all over again. But it's been quite a journey, and now this new version that we have is definitely a lot better than what we started when we were in college or high school. Even in high school, drawing stick figures. So that's really something that I appreciate about him.
I understand you guys have a trailer.
Yes, we do.
The latest project you guys are working on.
Yeah.
Let's take a look at the trailer.
We need to move so you guys can appreciate it.
Dad? Where are you going?
Every opponent is a riddle itself. They might look like a difficult or even impossible puzzle, but if you keep calm and think, you'll see through their weaknesses.
So, you'll have your final test with Shiro-sensei today, I see?
Yeah. I hope it won't be having to solve one of his stupid riddles.
I don't think you'd ever pass that one.
Ha ha! Very funny, Karen. Well, you're probably right.
What's going on?
Well, it looks like we're supposed to fight. Heck yeah! In that case, I'm saving you for last, Shotter!
Ha! Let's see if you make it that far, Ichi!
The key to solving this problem is right in your hands. All you need to do is choose wisely.
Impressive. You look pretty upset there, kid.
You're next.
Calm down. I'm not going anywhere.
Calm down? How about you give me some answers? Who are you people? Why are you after me? And what is that thing that bit me?
Are you still not impressed?
How did they get past our security?
Who are you?
Razor Ray!
You'll get all your answers, don't worry. But for now, let me show you something very nice.
What the?
I knew you'll like it.
Now you, Shada Kuratachi. Your last name belongs to a legend. Let's see if you fight like one.
Stick figures to that.
I was just gonna say that.
Yeah.
So that's kind of the meat of what this panel is about, the making of an audio manga. And so, having seen this, and in case you guys didn't know, not only is it all their artwork, from storyboarding to story, to writing the script, to just creating the incredible trailer and all the motion in it, all of the audio that you hear is original composition, so they made all the music as well. Can you guys talk a little bit about what it takes to go from sketches to something like this?
Well, in one word, it's just practice and having the passion to, like, you know, put the hours, put the time into develop your skills, and, you know, not sleep sometimes, just to make sure you're doing it the best you can. Sometimes I look at my old writings, for in my case, I'm like, no, I can write this better. So I rewrite the whole thing, and then I'll tell Pedro, hey, we need to do this again. And Pedro's like, oh, really? I'm like, yeah, but he appreciates, he understands, like, if I tell him that, it's because it's something that's going to improve the panel or the page or improve the scene and the story in general.
So to answer the question that was, yeah, so we are musicians. We started playing, we play music. I play drums, he plays guitar. So our interest was to have a band. It's been a really long journey. We at first tried to have a band, but then we started drawing. We were doing both at the same time. As you can see on the screen, I used to draw traditionally, and that's how I started. And I transitioned to digital. But since we didn't get the band going, we decided to do something else. Which
what was that transition like? How many of you guys are still pen and paper in your sketches? And how many of you guys are drawing digital now? What are some of your thoughts on that transition? How does that work for you?
Definitely, for me, definitely helped to start traditionally before I started digitally. I think getting us to a certain level in the traditional method definitely helped when I transitioned to digital. I wouldn't be able to say for sure how if someone's starting as a digital artist, if it would be better or if it would be worse, but I would definitely always recommend starting traditionally, getting used to that feeling, drawing, getting to a certain level on that, and then transitioning to digital.
What's been the biggest challenge in doing digital artwork? Do you have having come from ink and paper, what was the most challenging part about, you know, learning digital and doing it?
I actually think it's easier since you have Control Z.
Yeah.
You can undo, like, even while you're inking, you can undo that if you make a mistake. So it's actually a lot easier now that I was so used to doing traditional artwork and then transitioning to digital. There's a lot of tools. I have rulers, like perspective rulers, that really help a lot with some of the backgrounds and things like that. I've come to a point where sometimes I'm drawing traditionally again, and I make a mistake, and I'm looking for the Control Z. Even while drawing traditional, I'm like, wait, no, that's not how it works. So that's just one downside. You get so used to drawing digitally that drawing traditionally is not the same. But there's something special about drawing traditionally that I really appreciate. Yeah, and even as I was working on the manga, I was working so much on digital platforms that when I transitioned to did a traditional artwork again, it felt like refreshing. It felt like I was starting over again.
Nostalgic,
yeah. And it really helped to when I got back to digital. It was like I had new inspiration, like some sort. So I think knowing both ways of doing it is definitely the best way to go. Just not focusing on one or the other, like. Having a balance of both ways of doing it is definitely the best, in my opinion.
So, in this, you guys have a lot of different, you have your own unique style, you have your own visual language. Can you guys talk a little bit about where you guys get your style inspiration from, not only from visuals that we see, but in terms of story and what you're creating?
Yeah, so like we were talking about earlier, we started with various anime, Dragon Ball, for me personally, was Dragon Ball, Naruto, Pokemon, and everything. But even recently, we have started watching a lot of the Disney art style. So we have...
They showed me this the other day when we were on the phone. It's really, really cool.
Yeah, back in 2016.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, back in 2016, there was a challenge going on Instagram, art style challenge. So we did the different art style for one of our characters.
You guys have seen this art style?
Yeah.
Yes.
That's cool.
And that's definitely a good practice if you study different styles and then apply that to your own.
Being able to come up with your own visual language and find out what is your style like. Practicing other people's styles.
Yeah, practicing other people's styles, studying it pretty much. It's just like when I read manga, I'm not just reading it for the story. I'm actually studying the art style and the layout, how they do things, why they do things like that. When I'm reading manga, I'm not just reading it for reading to read. I actually read it to study. So that's something that if anybody's starting right now, or if you have been in the drawing for a little bit, it's definitely a good idea to study other artists and not compare yourself to them, but study it and apply it to yourself.
So with this project, Iridescent, you guys are doing something very unique. In the style audio manga. So how did you guys go from just making drawing? What is an audio manga? How did you guys come to that? What is that?
So that was all, he's the brain of the company. I'm like, I always say this, but he gets mad at me for it. I'm like Haku and he's Sabusa. But if you know the reference, it's from Naruto. But he says that I shouldn't compare it to that because I'm not just a tool. But that's the way I see it. He's like the brain of the company, and I'm like the hand. So he's the one that made everything happen, pretty much. He's the one that's been networking, contacting all the voice actors, and I'm just the artist in a way. That's the way I see it. But of course, he gets feedback from me. I give him feedback and all that. But coming to the point of making an audio manga, that was his idea, and I'm gonna let him take over to explain that.
So yeah, pretty much in the art world and in the manga world, it's a very competitive world, and we wanted to do something to make us stand out a little more. So we're like, why don't we do like a motion manga, right, or something of that nature? And we did some tests, we did some small animations and things of that nature, and we determined it was gonna take a little too longer to to do a motion manga per se. So at that time, we started looking into getting into finding voice actors. What if we get voice actors and have them join this our project and voice some of the characters for us? What would it take? And through the same guy that I met, Colin, I met Leraldo, and he put me in contact with Brittany and some other voice actors, and we got this thing started that way back in 2013. But the majority of my voice cast I got online. One of my actresses, she's part of this voice actress forum back in 2013, and she made a post. We together made a post, and we did our first casting call. And we were like, oh, whatever, we're just going to put a few characters there. We're going to get like 30 submissions and review them. And long story short, I opened my computer the other day, check my email, and we get more than 100 submissions for all the characters. I'm like, oh my gosh, we need to review this. So it got to a point like Pedro and I will come back from work just to review the auditions and listen to all of them. So at the end of the process, we end up picking the best of the best of the guys that applied to be part of the cast. And that's how we got the majority of our cast. A lot of them have blew up, actually. A lot of the people we met back in 2013, they're actually doing really cool stuff like Fire Emblem and My Hero Academia and stuff like that. But right now, they work with us first.
That's actually our mutual friend, Leraldo Andalua, is how I met you guys. He called me up and told me you guys were working on this project. I know that you said earlier on, too, it's a lot about who you know in the business, and I can attest, having done a lot of voiceover stuff, who you know is a part of it, but having something creative that's inspiring is definitely bigger. Having something that inspires people that they want to be a part of, you guys absolutely did that. Your very first casting call, very first audition, how did you even know what you were looking for? How did you?
Before all that, I do want to add that it took a lot of failure too. We had our manga already set to go. According to us, we were going to present it to Tokyo Pop. We sent it to Shonen Jump, and we got rejected. Sometimes they didn't even look at it. So it took a lot of failure for us to realize that, hey, maybe we just need to figure out a way for us to stand out on our own on a different way. So that's how the idea to do a motion comic came. When we realized the motion comic idea was going to be too not the right path for our story, that's when we decided to do the audio manga.
By the way, I know you met Colin and Brittany here, but would you guys like to meet some of the other voice actors that we have on the cast? Okay, let's do it.
Hey everyone, this is Leraldo Anzaldúa. I voice Shatter Kuratachi in Iridescent Manga. That's my cat, his name is Salem.
Hi everybody, my name is Kayla Martin. I am the voice actress behind Kimi Ray, as well as Kid Shatter in Iridescent.
Hey, I'm River. I play Rex and Kuratachi in Iridescent.
Hi, my name is Matthew Curtis, and I play Novir Sinless, as well as Shiro Sensei.
Patience, my lazy student.
One of the cool things that attracted me to Iridescent Manga was when I first met them, these were two guys that wanted to draw something really cool for themselves and to create independent, kind of individual art.
I can't remember exactly when I joined, but I remember being completely captivated by the story and the characters. I thought Kimi's, as well as all the other characters' designs, were gorgeous.
I remember when I first auditioned, it was years ago, and I saw the art report and I was just like, I have to be a part of this project. And luckily I am.
One of the first things that stood out to me about Iridescent was the quality and attention to detail in the artwork. Simon, Pedro, and the team have a passion for this project that really shines through.
The passion behind the project was contagious, and I really wanted to be a part of it, and I'm so glad that I am.
I thought that ambition that they had was really fun. I thought they had really great talent and really great potential for the story, so I wanted to jump on board.
At this point, I've only got to spend a few sessions so far with Rexon, but he's immediately a very likable, personable character. He wears some of the biggest shoes, but he loves and believes in his son Shatter's ability to fill them.
One of the things that I really like about playing Shatter Kuratachi is that character in particular is really fun and adventurous, and he has a really cool journey and arc through his story. At first, he's young and naive, and he doesn't really know the world. He wants to follow in his father's footsteps, but he doesn't really know what's going on yet. He doesn't know, like, politics of the game, and he gets a little bit lost. And through the journey, through Iridescent Manga and the tournament that he goes to and the teachings that he gets, he learns a lot, he grows a lot, and he gets better at kind of anticipating the choices of his own life.
I've had a great time voicing Kimi. It's always fun to play characters who are so vastly different than myself. She's so spunky, she has a big personality. I can't say that I relate to her too much. She's deadly, she's violent, but I can say that I can kind of relate to her confidence in herself as well as her loyalty to those she cares about. Those are two traits that I think we have in common.
Rexon is a louder personality than I would typically relate to, but I could definitely relate to doing your best to try and use your position to uplift those who might look up to you.
Nobuo Zinless is just so cool, and Shiro Sensei, he's such a great caring figure and a great role model for the characters in the manga, and I'm just having a brilliant time voicing these characters.
At this point, I can't wait to share it with everyone. I can't wait till everyone gets to see the finished product with the voiceover. A lot of effort had been put into the initial development, and a lot of effort has been put in since.
It's really cool to go from the beginning of an inception of an idea and take it all the way even this far to know that it's going to go further. And that's really, really exciting to me. I really enjoy the personable nature that we have, the connection that with Simon and Pedro Blaze, how we all have this connection together and how we help support one another through this project. I'm really proud and happy to be part of this project. So please check it out. Go by the tables, check out their manga, go look at their art, and get to know a little bit more about Iridescent Manga. Thanks very much, everybody. I'm glad you're here.
I hope you enjoy the rest of this panel, and I hope to see you on the next one.
Yeah, one thing I can speak to that reflects what they said in the video is it was exciting to be a part of this project because when we were first brought on board, it was at the beginning stages, and it evolved even while, not only while we were voicing it, but like through the years. And so to see like their dedication and drive to keep evolving and getting better and you know, going the route that they went, like, it's been so cool to be a part of this project.
Sorry, I'm just really distracted by this footage. Who was that? So I don't really know how I got involved still. I know we had a conversation, but I don't know if I chose my character. Yeah, I had to have been there. I'm so glad that I got to play the character that I'm playing, Ichi Wolf. Like, growing up, the characters that I related to were the Vegetas, the Hiyas, you know, the Seto Kaibas. Like, I like the supporting characters who were badass but always got beat up by the hero, and I still kind of hold out that one day they'll win. It'll never happen, though. But I love those kind of characters, and luckily, I get to play a character like that in Iridescent Destination Tournament. I'm Shatter Kuratachi's like rival, but his best friend, and man, I really love that role. If I could choose my first voice acting role, it would have been this character. And so I can't thank you guys enough for giving me that opportunity. I think the other thing I have to like cross off my list is one day voicing Skeletor or something. But otherwise, like, you guys have made a little kid's dream come true. Thank you.
So in addition to the art, the voiceover, you guys are your own studio now, Blaze Media.
I mean, not exactly. In a way, yes. We knew we needed to team up and do something serious with this. But when we were younger, we thought the only way to make it was through applying to different companies like Shonen Jump or Marvel or DC. And throughout the years, we started getting small gigs. Like somebody will ask us, "Hey, can you design this logo for us? Or can you draw this character for us?" And through meeting people and networking, that's how we move up in the ladder. And from after doing gigs for a little bit, we decided, why don't we do the Aris Alley? I see we go to conventions. We went to Matsuri. That was our first anime convention a few years back.
2015.
Yeah. Oh, wow. And we walked through the Aris Alley. We see a lot of people, very talented people, and we're like, why don't we do the same? Yeah. So we started doing Aris Alley, and that's how we started this business, started kicking up. That was our first anime Matsuri.
Our first anime Matsuri.
You were blind.
I was blonde.
If you have any questions, don't bring a screen into your first convention, because people will walk and look at the screen and they won't buy anything. And that's in San Japan. That was the same year.
I gotta say, the first thing that you said really struck me, and my wife and I are doing this now. When you said that you thought that the only way to make it would be to hook up with or work for a big established studio. And there's something that I didn't learn late in life, that you don't have to dedicate your life to making somebody else's dream come true. Like, you can do it. You can trade your time and your effort working at somebody else's company or somebody else's job to make their dream come true. But I think that's the inspiration that Geraldo and a lot of other people, and certainly that I saw, that what you guys are doing is making your own dream a reality. And I think that's the gravitational force to what you're doing. Very impressive as well. It was really nice to hear you say that you saw the option, the road well traveled, of working for somebody else, and you decided not to take it out. So, props to you.
Yeah, and especially when you have the passion for it, like, it doesn't feel like work. Even if you spend hours, like I said earlier, it's out of love. It's not out of duty or out of, you know, for a paycheck. The money will come later. The fame will come later. But as long as you are fulfilled professionally and creatively, that's what the most important to me. But do you guys have any questions for us? We're going to have a Q&A question. Just get your questions ready. But I want to show you one more thing before the questions.
Whoa! Hold your tacos, Sensei. How am I supposed to know which object is the right one? You just want me to guess?
Ha ha ha! I was waiting for you to ask that.
Huh? What's this?
Go ahead, read it out loud.
I have two faces, yet I'm joined as one. I stand still, and I can still run faster than some. What am I? What the hell is this?
That's your clue. When you solve this riddle, you'll know which object to choose, and the test will be over.
This is my test? Solving a stupid riddle? I don't know if you remember, but I'm going to a fighting tournament. Shouldn't you be testing my fighting skills? Man, you are getting old. How is solving a riddle going to help me in battle, huh?
Every opponent is a riddle itself. They might look like a difficult or even impossible puzzle, but if you keep calm and think, you'll see through their weaknesses. Once you know what they are, it'll be just a matter of making the right move. You've already seen the answer. All you need to do is choose wisely. The key to solving this problem is right in your hands. So, let's not waste any more time. Begin!
I'm so bored. How long was that test supposed to be anyway? That's right. I haven't eaten anything since lunch. I guess it's time for a little snack. Let's see. What do we have in here? Huh. A text message. What? doesn't even make sense.
Damn, that was close. I better finish this mission undetected.
Who are you? It seems that I have a stalker. So creepy. What am I gonna do with you? Huh?
Let's open it up to Q&A. Do you guys have any questions? Now, unfortunately, we only have one microphone, so I'm going to have to do a little bit of running back and forth for the audio. Here we go.
Thank you. Hello, I'm Matt. I just wanted to ask you about sound design and music. Can you tell me a little bit about like how you got that all together?
So, like I was mentioning earlier, the music, we wrote most of it. Now, after we started drawing, doing a lot of the work with the drawing, we realized that it was a really big workload for us to do the music and the art. So we started hiring people to do the work for us, do the sound design and music for us. That was all through networking. Simon took care of that. So we had a guy who, all the sounds and everything, sound effects, they were designed from scratch by someone we met on YouTube. So he contacted someone in YouTube. He researched people who were sound engineers, sound designers, and he contacted them to see if they could work with us and design some of the work for, some of the sound design for us.
When it comes to the music, we try working out with different composers, but it's a little bit more complicated than you might think. So we decided, no, let's just do it ourselves. And we downloaded. We're skilled. Like, we have a really good drummer, and we're really creative. So we downloaded a bunch of professional VST packs and put everything together on the softwares. Most of it is digital, but we hire musicians to help us with some of the aspects of the soundtrack. But it's just teamwork pretty much when it comes to the music. It's just coming up with an idea and working on it until it sounds the way we envision it with different people. Yeah.
Excellent. I think we have another question over here.
It's all you. Oh. I'm Liz. I guess my question is more for the voice actors, and that is, how much time do you get ahead of time with the material? Do you have cold reads? And then what is the editing process like? And do you coach them on kind of the personality? I'm madly curious. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a great, great question. I think we did get to see our lines ahead of time. But I don't think we necessarily saw the artwork, so we didn't really have context until we got into the booth and started actually recording. And so these guys actually did coach us along the way of like, here's the background, here's what's happening in this situation, here's, you know, kind of where your character is going and what you're feeling. And that was super, super helpful. And then once we got to see the visuals of it, that also helps to get an idea of, you know, what the character sounds like and how to go about that. Did I answer all of your questions? I feel like you had another one. Oh, editing.
What was the question when it comes to editing?
Like, how do we put it all together?
Oh, well, pretty much after I get the voices, the tracks, I go to Premiere and I put the artwork, making sure it matches with the voices, and then I add the sound effects later on. And then after I have a sketch of what I want, I send that to somebody else so they can add the proper sound effects. And then the scoring is the last part. We put the music in the last part. Yes?
So one interesting thing is that some of these voice actors have never even met themselves in person. So some of them are like all over the States, and they send us the files through like Google Drive or Dropbox, and then he edits all of that together. So I think it's really interesting to see people who have never met each other. They probably don't even know each other exists, and then seeing it all together, almost as if they were interacting with each other. I think that's a really cool thing about the editing.
I'm so glad you brought that up. So like when you're in the booth, we have, headphones on, and we can hear Simon and Pedro in the studio, and they're giving us context to the scene. And we need that because without any of the artwork, none of this makes sense. You know what I mean? I mean, we're shouting out fighting moves and we're screaming and saying names. Like, it's, you know, it's ridiculous. So when you're reading it on the page, you have, you need context. And that's really where the artwork comes in. And since we were doing so much of the voice acting without it, having them in our ear, telling them, hey, okay, you're fighting 100 people. Okay, now you're down to just fighting Shotter. And now you're in the fort. Like, that is really what we hear when we're in the booth. Without that, I don't think it would sound nearly as good.
And to that point, I think the hardest lines you have are all like the little ones, like the like, that took a lot of direction of like, okay, what kind of am I going to do? So I think we're like, there was one day that I had like all those lines and you're like, no, not like that, like this. And I kept like doing one line. I was like, oh, crap. Like, yeah, 30 takes of one, And then another note, like, this is so different from, like, whenever you guys see an anime that's dubbed, this is completely different because you're doing it from scratch. You're not trying to match somebody else's voice or emotions or another character and their mouthing. It's completely different. So you have that freedom to kind of play with it more. It's pretty fun.
Yeah, and sometimes magic just happens on the booth. Sometimes there's lines that they say by accident. I'm like, I like how that sounds, and then I write them off into the story. That happens a few times. Like, they say something, I'm like, I like how that sounds. Let's make Aaron do that. Mm-hmm. And that ended up making it into the final take.
Excellent. Do we have any other questions? Yes.
Actually, that kind of goes into what I was going to ask. How much of your story was kind of fleshed out, like, early on in the beginning, and how much has kind of evolved, or whether it's from the voice actors or just kind of your own? It's like, well, you know, that probably wasn't as well thought out as I thought, so you'll add some things or take away some things to kind of add some cohesion to the story or just something that fits better. How much of that is of the original storyline has been changed, added throughout the entire time?
That's a really good question, because it has changed so much. Like, we had the concept pretty much from when it started. All we have left of that is just the concept. Like, we want the main character to go through a tournament, and that's it. That's all we have from the original story. Everything else in the past 6 years has been rewritten, revised, and taking a lot of inspiration from different shows, and that's how he has been added to the story to make it more cohesive. And
I think a lot of projects are like that. It has to remain a growing organism so that, you know, it stays alive.
That's correct. Yeah, a lot of projects are like that. It needs to grow. Yeah.
I just gonna say, as a writer, sometimes the story evolves on you. Like, you're writing something and it becomes something bigger than you were initially thinking it was gonna become, and yeah, it's always evolving. Even we're releasing this in August, and we're still, you know, making changes for the next volume and the next volume, because you do that one small change, and then there's a butterfly effect. So you need to readjust some things later on. But yeah, it's an evolving thing, and that's part of what I love about this process, is just making it better every time. Yeah. We have any more questions?
That works really well, unless it's a TV series like Lost that they just started making it up.
When you're in the first stages, what's it like going from your work-life balance to trying to dedicate to your story that you're trying to write?
I'm pretty sure you don't want to hear from me. I can mention being a filmmaker and trying to have a work-life balance. It's not easy, I can tell you that much. I manage it by having part-time jobs, flexible jobs. For years, I was a substitute teacher, which was great, because you get to choose your, you know, the days that you work. And I can kind of, you know, pop in and work whenever I want. And, whenever I'm available, I can film projects or music videos, in my free time. But how these guys manage it, I have no clue. So I'm going to pass the microphone to those guys because they're the MVPs.
And just to add to that, I think for any artist, it takes a lot of sacrifice and dedication. Like, for anything that you're super passionate about, like, you just have to keep at it. But you also have to realize, like, okay, I might not be able to go hang out with my friends, but tonight I'm going to, you know, work on my stuff. Like, I think if you keep that mindset and keep that drive, you will go really far.
I was gonna say that. You stole that line from Simon. But yes, sacrifice, that's a really big point. Sleep has been most of my sacrifice.
What is sleep
anyway? But now you got used to it. Your body is used to it. But I do not recommend sleeping less than 6 hours a day. You need to sleep. But you do need to sacrifice. I'm lucky enough to have a flexible job where I only work 4 days a week, and then I have the whole weekend or at least 3 days to work on my project. But even during the days that I'm working, I get off work and then I go home and I sit down and draw. So I just is using your time wisely, time management, and just having the passion for it. If as long as you have the passion for it, you don't even feel tired. Like sometimes I get off work, let's say at 6 o'clock, and then I'm working all the way till midnight, and I'm like, God, I want to keep working on this, but I need to sleep because I need to get up tomorrow. So yeah, sometimes you make yourself sleep because you have to, but it's just that, just sacrificing a little bit of here and there just to make it happen for yourself. As long as you have the passion, you can make it happen.
Well, guys, thank you so much for coming. We could talk about this for hours, but we need to wrap up. As a thank you for coming to this panel, we have a special gift for you. So before you leave, find Emmanuel right here, the guy in the corner, and he has a special package for you since we're in the Artist Alley. Oh, first, you can find Iridescent on August 21st. You can pre-order it on our Etsy store right here, Blaze-Manga Etsy store. And you can find us this weekend at the Artist Alley in just across the hall. And if you have any more questions, just come say hi to our, just come talk to us in our booth, say hi, and they're going to be hanging out with us for a little bit, and they're going to be here today, but we're going to be here all weekend. So thank you so much for coming, and find my brother so he can give you a gift.